I'm a programmer, okay? I am a programmer, dude. It's not funny. I'm a programmer, okay? Dude, stop laughing. Trust me, I am one. I'm a programmer, okay? You keep trying to convince your friends, but they use the forbidden tactic of portraying you as the soy wojack while making themselves the chat, invalidating any point you may want to make, having you become a laughingstock. Any further attempt is futile, as the mistake of mentioning your programming language of choice is HTML put the last nail in the coffin of your social standing, prospects, any potential you may have had as a human being, and even your status of a being possessing some level of intelligence. This used to be the harsh, disgraceful life of someone using HTML, as people claimed it wasn't a programming language just because you didn't have variables, conditional statements, iterative looping structures, or some other irrelevant stuff, until now. Just to show the normies the prowess of this language, I added those boring functionalities in, and some other stuff, just so they can get an image of what HTML is capable of. I present you... Now, let's unchicanery for a second. I made this simply because I thought it would be funny, and figured I'd try to do something entirely useless just to commit to the bit. Also, to better deliver this unorthodox and brilliant idea to you, I figured I'd go through my entire thought process in chronological order as I developed this project, as it's not that complicated from a technical standpoint, and so I began by creating the input file, as I figured that would both serve as a canvas to structure what I want this language to look and operate like, trying to get as much of a concise version as possible, as XMLs tend to be quite tedious to look at if not managed properly, and also become a guide for developing the parser and compiler, as I thought it would be best to include every possible functionality I deemed essential, thus having every desired case covered when I get to implementing and testing the flow. By the way, did you know you can like and subscribe? Yeah, I guess you knew that. Oh, I meant liking this video and subscribing to this channel, but I guess you knew that too. First, I had to decide where the script would be located and how permissive I should be with it. I initially thought I should allow snippets to be placed anywhere and be available to any sibling of the script node and their children. Kinda like namespaces, which was also the way I would be translating them to JS. But then, I realized just how confusing it would make development, with random bits of code placed here and there, capitalizing on the incredible readability of a complex XML file. So, I relegated this to only allowing codes to be placed inside script tags, and then taking all these scripts marked by the type equals JSX attribute and combining them under the global namespace, trusting the developer to be creative enough not to reuse the same names hundreds of times. Next, I wanted to allow two special tags to be used, call, which would be replaced with the return value of the function called, and CLI, which would act like a classic terminal, having a historical feed and the current line serving as input. The call would take the name of the function as an attribute and parameters provided as children nodes. The CLI would take the name of its driver or main function, enforcing the rule that this function needs to be declared as async and have a CLI main meta property. Additionally, I wanted to be able to bind the value of input fields to declared variables. In the end, I settled for these conventions for declaring a variable, setting or updating a variable, creating an if-else statement, a for loop, a while loop, declaring a function and its signature, its parameters, its metadata, reading and writing from and to a CLI instance, and returning from a function. Knowing I had an input file to process, I moved on to parsing it, storing the head and the body, making sure to replace the call and CLI tags with valid HTML tags. But wait, no, I changed my mind because I realized trying to manage variables for each CLI in the same file would be pain, so I decided to keep it as is and then create a Svelte component to match it and its functionality. Yeah, I'm using Svelte for compiling. For the script tags, I had to check whether they were classic ones, so that I add them accordingly using the Svelte head component, or of my own creation, aka using the JSX type attribute, for which I used an abstract syntax tree, where each node holds information regarding the corresponding XML element, and to parse it, aka convert it to a string, I just need to traverse it using depth-first-search using a bunch of yucky ifs before and after the recursive call, marking the start and end of the encapsulating statement. For example, when I had a function call, I would check if the current node is of type function call, verify it has a name attribute, then start the statement by appending the name and an open bracket to mark the start of the encapsulating scope. Then go on to the recursive call, which would convert the parameters, which are leaves in this case, so there would be no further recursive call, to their name properties, each followed by a comma. Then, when returning from processing these leaves, the string would now be as follows. So, to close the scope, I would need to remove the trailing comma. I am sure there are better ways of doing this. and append a closing bracket to obtain the entire function call statement. I now had all the separate parts needed to be combined and compiled. To do this, I first created a Svelte project in which I created a CLI component to be imported at the top of the script section. This CLI component would have variables binded to the input elements, as well as a check for when the user presses the enter key, so I know to signal the flushing of new input. It would also need functions for reading and writing respectively. The writing function was straightforward, simply appending to the binded variable for the historical feed, but the read one was a bit trickier. You see, to read means you need a blocking mechanism, so that execution doesn't progress until the user provides some input. So, inside the main function loop, you would have to wait for input to be submitted, just like in any other programming language. Thus, the need for the async property. Now, waiting for that input was a matter of trade-offs. Because JS runs in a single thread, I can't simply write a while loop iterating over and over until some input is received, as that would simply overload the web page and crash it. So, I had the function return a promise, in which at a set interval it would poll for whether new input has been submitted. I also had to find a polling interval that would not slow down the page and also not feel like you're playing a game with 1000 ping, ending up with 500 milliseconds as a decent enough value. To top it off, I had it so that when a function was marked as CLI main, I would add two parameters to its declaration, write to CLI and read from CLI. The functions declared previously, which would be then used anywhere I used the CLI read or CLI write tags in the input script. And to have all this compiled as a static site, meaning pre-rendering the entire site as a collection of static files, I had to modify the svelte.config file to use the svelte static adapter. Thus, now when building this project, it would be written as a main HTML file along with its style and script modules link. What was left was to have it so I don't need to navigate to the svelte projects folder and run the build command myself and then move the output to where it needed to be. So, using Python's subprocess module, I could set the current working directory for the command to be issued in. By the way, I had to find out I needed to specify npm.cmd to run the actual npm command and not simply npm, because by default subprocess would search for an executable by the name npm inside the current working directory to execute instead. This was done using the run command of that module, which also returns as a result of the execution, whose status is what I used to decide if the compilation was successful and raise an error otherwise. Finally, I copied the contents of the build folder to the destination selected by the user and renamed the HTML file to that desired by the user. And with that, I now have a fully functional compiler for HTML, as it has decidedly become a programming language. I wish. This entire project was definitely a jokish one, but it certainly wasn't funny when I realized what it would take for someone to actually make a language and all its necessary tools from scratch. My project can't even tell what errors you may have created in your confusion, simply throwing an ominous message. Which, fair, it's pretty funny for an outsider watching you try to create something, but it shows just how important even this side of using a language is. Never mind all the stuff that it's supposed to be able to do when not throwing errors. Hell, even for how few instructions I've added, most of the heavy lifting is done by Svelte. And all this makes me realize just how much we owe programming language creators, how little we would be able to achieve without them. And also how I would never want to be in their shoes, cause what the f***? Couldn't be me, I wouldn't touch the with a 1000-yard pole even at gunpoint. I'd wish you good luck, but there's no such thing for you.